Hey Neil, what are you making today?
Well Amy, I'm going to show you how you can set up a receive node to collect ADS-B signals from aircraft a few hundred kilometres around your house and contribute them to OpenSky or other plane tracking services. But why? Wouldn't it be great if there was a way to reflect microwave radio signals off something high in the sky so you could communicate with folks hundreds of miles away or on the other side of the hills? We just need some damn great big sheets of metal way up in the air. Thousands of them. Luckily, in 1853, Sir George Cayley, who lived in this area, invented something called an aeroplane. Half a century later, Wilbur Wright and his brother put an engine in one, and the rest is history. Radar uses scatter and reflection, so you can stop flying objects from being unidentified, but those reflections are really weak. To get a signal to your friend 500 miles away needs that specular reflection, like the flash of sun in a mirror. Now all we need is a way to predict when a plane will be in exactly the right place, height and orientation to bounce your signal to the distant receiver. Most aircraft of a usable size broadcast ADS-B signals on 1.09 GHz, reporting all the details we need, including the model, heading, speed and height. Sounds great! Cloud-based systems like ADS-B Exchange, OpenSky and the commercial systems collate ADS-B reports via a network of local receive nodes all over the world. Airscout's a program that uses a local or cloud ADS-B feed to show which planes are in the reflection zone, and even better, it predicts which planes might be in the zone soon. Because I'm a microwave machinist, I'll start with machining the antenna mount. I'm using a commercial colinear dipole array from Jetvision. It has 5 dBi gain. Details are in the description. I want it to look neat and tidy, so I'm machining a bush for the top of a 2-inch aluminium mast that'll fit the 32mm OD of the antenna mount. It'll have a spigot that slips inside the mast with the OD flush with the outside of the tube. That does mean that the coaxial cable will be unsupported inside the 4-metre tube, which is less than ideal, but I might fix that later. I'm using a bit of 2-inch aluminium round bar. There's a lot of stick out, but it's too big for the headstock tube and I think I'll get away with it. Waste not, want not, as my grandma used to say. She also said things like "f***er" when the cat bit her ankles, but that's not important right now. A quick chamfer will preserve my fingers from injury, but it's also a civilising influence, according to the wisdom of that great philosopher machinist, Quinn Dunkey. I don't know why I'm using a centre drill here, it's not like this hole's critical or anything. Force of habit perhaps. Although this bit was sitting on the tailstock just begging to be used. I'm using a 10mm stub drill, it's nice and sharp and stiff and the hole's shallow. Next, it's a 17mm cobalt jobber. And finally, the Empire strikes back with a nice blacksmith drill, 3 barleycorns in diameter. That's 25.4mm for those listeners using metric loudspeakers. I'll get the hole to final size using a boring bar equipped with a lapped carbide insert. To keep chatter and resonances under control, I'll reduce the stick out to the minimum.
That insert looks a bit tired, doesn't it?
It'll be fine.
Famous last words.
Those stringy chips look like razor wire. I think you were right, AIMEE. I'd better swap it out. The new inserts are YG1 from Cutwell. And before anyone comments about the dangers of undoing those little tiny screws over the chip tray, I put a bit of pig mat down first. Well, the chips are still stringy, but they're much, much smoother and the finish is gorgeous. Before AIMEE or anyone scolds me for leaving that spiral groove in the bore, this wasn't actually the finishing cut. On that one, I moved the tool away from the workpiece on the way out. I'm loving having a full set of 3-point bore mics, even though they're a wild mix of makes and ages. This one's a cheapo Oxford job. Right, parting off time. If you're enjoying this, or even if you're not, I'd be immensely happy if you'd click the like button, and even subscribe. All that remains for lathe work is finishing the parted face and chamfering the corner and bore. That machined surface that I'm so carelessly chucking onto ends up inside the rough bore of the mast, so no complaints please, AIMEE.
The expression on my face says it all. Amateur.
finding the centre of the part to put the grub screw holes in using a centre finder. Good name, it says what it does. That little peep is where I pressed the half button, so the DRO now zeroes right in the centre line of the part. The threaded holes are going to be M6 by 1.0, so I'm drilling a 5mm pilot hole. That's a Volkel spiral point tap. Quick clean up with a three flute countersink should make sure I can get the screws in even on a cold, dark, rainy night. That's the last machining operation on the collar, so time for a test fit to make sure the antenna fits properly. I think that'll do. I'm kind of shocked to find it's dark outside. Winter is coming. Software and electronics setup will be in the next thrilling episode. Thanks for watching and subscribing. Try this one next.